The first topic of our IAP Dharma module, that is infant skin barrier, which is a basic for our next subsequent topics. Over to Dr. Basavaraj, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Vinod, for an excellent coordination with the faculties like Dr. Jelly Lama, sir, Dr. Mahanti Shmati, Dr. Som Sundaram, Dr. Pawan Kalyan, and many more Randhwa sir and Nandini madam also. So first of all, let me thank IAP Tamil Nadu State President Dr. Ismail, Secretary Dr. Rajendran, our Chennai City branch as well as Ramanathpuram also for organizing this wonderful workshop. First of all, this skin, when you talk about a skin barrier, this is a very, very important to understand in day-to-day practice, because as a pediatrician, we are going to take care of a newborn and an infant. So once if you understand the basic things, why it is relevant, it becomes a much more easier. Let's understand what is this is infant skin. Most of the time it acts as a good skin barrier. It prevents the transepidermal water loss. It acts like a mechanical barrier. Prevents the entry of microbes, prevents the entry of chemicals, allergens, and irritant. Protection from the harmful radiation and thermal protection and immune surveillance. This is a diagram. This is, as an undergraduate, we all read, when you look at in a skin layer consists of a stratum corneum, lucidum, granulosum, and spinosum, and stratum basilae. But as a barrier and as a pediatrician, what we are concerned is stratum corneum. Stratum corneum acts as the most important part of the barrier. This consists of a corneocytes and corneodesmosomes and lipids. So corneocytes acts as a bricks. These corneocytes, this acts like a brick, and intracellular lipid acts like a mortar. So that means, this acts like a very good barrier for many things. When you look at the difference between the adult skin and the infant skin's corneocytes are less, granular cells also smaller, and the stratum corneum and epidermis that is thinner, and pigmentation is less as compared to that of an adult. So this is the thing which is very relevant as a barrier. So when these are things are smaller and less and thin, so that makes the skin is more susceptible. When you look at the composition, how it is different from that of an adult skin, infant skin, how it different from adult skin is natural moisturizing factor concentration is lower. pH is much higher in a neonate because acidic pH is a very important thing because acidic pH acts like in a barrier. And sebum production will be very less in the, especially 7 to 12 months. Stratum corneum water content will be higher as compared to that of an adult. So this is how it is differences in the composition of an infant skin from that of an adult. Let's look at how the functions differ. When you know the structure and composition, let's look at how the functionality is different. Rate of water absorption is much higher in an infant skin as compared to that of an adult skin. Rate of water disruption is higher in the case of an infant. Skin barrier function is competent and transepidermal water loss will be much higher. This transepidermal water loss is a very, very relevant, especially in a premature baby and neonate where the transepidermal water loss is much higher. We can expect a dehydration and electrolyte imbalances if we don't take care of this hydration part and electrolyte this one. Coming to the determinants of infant skin barrier, as I read in the previous slide, I mentioned about in a prematurity, gestational age plays an important role. Barrier development increases as the gestational age increases. Most of the time, it is competent by 34 weeks, though it continues to develop during the first year of life. And nutrition, malnutrition causes the changes in the surface of the lipid, especially in the protein energy malnutrition, we all get a lot of complication which is associated with nutritional things like a lot of dermatosis. skin diseases, certain skin diseases like atopic eczema and ichthyosis. Atopic is itself is an already Professor Nagaraj sir has brought it out. It's in a very, very important, not only allergic point of view, and also the pediatrician and dermatologist point of view. So this is in a one module which is going to be discussed in the later today itself. Adversely affect the skin barrier function. Coming to the environment plays an important role in the maintaining the infant skin barrier. If there is an high temperature, more transepidermal loss, humidity is also plays an important role. Use of in a tropical products can alter the skin barrier function. When you look at an effect of prematurity on the infant skin barrier, immature lipid barrier, thinner and gelatinous skin, more permeable within a transepidermal water loss. So in a case of a newborn and infancy, the pH is usually neutral. That makes it more susceptible for an infection. That's why we should be more aware about how do we take care of an infancy regarding an infection. Low sweat gland functions and less sebum formation, especially sebum formation peaks in the third trimester, and weaker epidermal cohesion, that makes an infant is more susceptible and barrier is likely to be disrupted. Keeping the skin, how do we keep the skin barrier healthy? That is what we are all interested as in a practicing healthcare provider, as in whether you are a dermatologist or a pediatrician or a neonatologist. One, our whole goal is to how do we keep this preservation by using a moisturizer. Optimizing the skin cleansing and bathing practices in the newborn and in infancy. Prevention of a friction and a body pore maceration, that's more important. Preserving the acidic pH is an important thing. When we talk about the soap and cleansing agent, we all talk about a pH. That is the reason. So we need to be much aware about the pH plays an important role in the skin barrier function. So how do we protect? By using a moisturizer, protection from the toxic products, enhancing by using a moisturizer. So when we talk about a moisturizer, we as a whether you are a dermatologist or in a pediatrician, most of the time we use a combination medicine. We use it in the newborn and infancy is in a moisturizer which is related to the skin. So moisturizers, which is necessary to preserve, protect, and enhance the skin, the barrier function, maintain the skin integrity, supply of stratum corneum with the water and lipids, inhibits the transepidermal water loss, may help in maintaining the acidic pH, improves the flexibility and smoothness of the skin, and relieves the itching. Especially in atopic dermatitis, itching is a major issue. So moisturizers will be very, very useful in that. There are three broad categories of moisturizer. One with the properties of an occlusive, that basically what it occlusive means, it is going to create an hydrophobic barrier on the top of the skin to prevent the water evaporation. The evaporation of water can be prevented. That is an occlusive. What about emectant? It is an hygroscopic compound. That means it draws the water from the environment and dermis to hydrate the epidermis. Basically, the whole emectant function is an hygroscopic thing to keeping the moisturizing of the epidermis. Emollient is mainly the lipids and oils that hydrates and improve the skin softness, flexibility, and smoothness. So when you look at in a skin moisturizer, examples of a different moisturizers, look at that, which are the hygroscopic, hydrophobic, that is petrolatum, mineral oil, beeswax, and silicon, and lanolin. These are all the occlusive type of a moisturizer. Whereas emectant, that is a glycerol, polyethylene glycol, urea, lactic acid, and panthenol, they basically, they're the hygroscopic, that means it draws the water from the environment to keep the epidermis in a good maintaining the moisturizing. Emollient, especially the cholesterol and squalene and pseudoceramides, fatty acids and fatty alcohols, these are all the emollient. Emollient is another thing where we commonly prescribe. Majority of the moisturizers which is available consists of a three vehicle basis. That is one, it could be in the form of an ointment, or it could be in the form of a cream or a lotion. So let's understand what is the clinical implication of these ointment, creams, and lotion. When do we advise an ointment as a moisturizer? When do we use a cream as a thing? When do you use a lotion as a moisturizing agent in the clinical practice. When do we prescribe an ointment? Is usually it is an occlusive as quite thick in consistency, preferred for the thick lesions and in the winter season. It consists of a least preservative. That's a very advantageous of an ointment. Less chances of stinging and burning. Maybe cosmetically is less acceptable when you look at the cosmetology as a thing. So wear ointment which is going to stay for a longer period of time, which may cosmetically may not be that acceptable thing. But a cream is one thing which comes in between the ointment and the lotion. Consistency is thinner than the ointment, but thicker than the lotion. This is the most commonly prescribed warm up in a moisturizer. What about lotions? Lotion is a thinner in consistency, so preferred for larger areas, especially airy areas, and in summer, cosmetically, it is more acceptable as compared to the ointment and creams. So lotion is a more acceptable thing cosmetically. What about role of oil as a moisturizer? So oil is one thing we traditionally used over in years by our ancestors, and even today, we are using it in a majority of the homes. So Indian households wear the commonest things, they use it as a moisturizer as well as a massaging. So they are mild occlusive. That means they prevent the loss of evaporation of a water. That's how it will be. What is the common oil we can prescribe in day-to-day practices? Coconut oil and sunflower oil. It is a more acceptable in practice. You can prescribe those things. But some of the time we try to write in a mustard oil, especially in northern part of India, or in olive oil, but it should be avoided. Reason is it is likely to cause an irritant or allergic reaction that defects in the skin barrier. Olive oil and mustard oil should be avoided because they are all likely to cause a barrier integrity. It is more problem rather than the advantages. So preferred is carry home message. You can use freely coconut oil. If you leave the coconut oil, the next oil we can use is sunflower oil. What feature should be the ideal in moisturizers to have it? Let's look into that. Reduces moisturizer is the one. It should be able to reduce and prevent the further transepidermal water loss. It restores the lipid barrier, hypoallergenic and pregnancy-free and non-comedogenic and minimum preservative. It should be minimum preservative. Preservative is always harmful. That means we should avoid as much as possible. Absorb quickly to hydrate the skin. Cosmetically, it should be acceptable and also it should be affordable. How to use a moisturizer? You can use it in a 2 to 3 times per day. You can use in a liberal use. If you are using by jar, use in a spatula. Do not, so when you are advising the parents, you make sure that they should not put the hand into that because that causes a lot of contamination, more likely to be spoiled quickly. That is why we should educate the parents quickly. Downward application to ensuring the applying it in a direction of an hair growth so that it prevents the follicle inflammation. Apply immediately after bath so as to trap more moisturizers. What about bathing and skin barriers? Bathing is a preferred than the wipe and wash as the baby is calmer and lessens heat loss. Scrubbing should be avoided as much as possible. You need to avoid a scrubbing. 5 to 10 minutes of bath is ideal for the newborn as prolonged bath increases the hydration, reduces the threshold for friction. So it is likely to be more damaged. So when you are advising the bathing in a newborn, it should not be more than 5 to 10 minutes. Baby should be bathed at least 2 to 3 times in a week to reduce the potential skin irritation and pH changes. So newborn, especially preterm, where you can avoid in the bathing repeatedly. So bath temperature should be close to the body water. So whenever using that water, it should be the body water temperature. It should not be too hot or it should not be cold also, where it causes any discomfort to the baby. So what about why we should use in a cleanser is water may not remove the greasy deposit on the skin. That is why cleanser is very, very important thing. Cleanser may able to improve by removing the sweat, sebum and deposit and oils and more effectively. That is why these are the things where you can use it in day-to-day practice. What are the composition or constituent of a cleansing agent is? It contains in a water. It is a surfactant, that is the emulsifier will be there. Moisturizers for an hydration, binder for a stabilizer, and leather enhancer in some of the things. Filler, especially Ardner, it contains a preservative that inhibits the microorganism. Preservative is required, but it should not contain too much. That is more harmful. So it should be able to inhibit the microorganism. Progress, especially master surfactant odor and dyes or pigments in some of the situation where you can use those things. So when you look at in the cleansing or in the skin barrier things, soaps are a prototypes of a cleanser which are alkaline in nature. Soap is the one of the commonest thing we all use it in things, but soap likely to cause an excoriation and more likely to have a more dangerous thing. That is why, so when you're using in a subsets of in soaps, you think about a glycerin bars where it is in a cause an hygroscopic effect where it is the moisture can be maintained with an absorption of water. That's why glycerin bars is a more relevant. Super petited soaps, that is a lipid to occlude the skin. Antibacterial soaps inhibit the bacterial growth. Syndex bars, non-soap synthetic surfactant, natural or slightly acidic pH and preserve the skin barrier. That is why Syndex bars are a more important thing. Non-soap synthetic surfactant, they are. Differences between the soap and synthetic detergent, that is synthetic detergent is in a Syndex. The soaps are alkaline in nature, can remove the natural moisturizing factor and lipids from the skin, leading to the dryness and erythema and irritation. More excoriation of the skin is likely, especially if the pH of the soap is alkaline. That is the time where it is more likely to cause a lot of problem. Syndex are acidic in nature because these are the synthetic detergent and preserve the integrity of the skin barrier. And Syndex liquid cleansers are more efficient than the bar. So when you are prescribing the things, if it is a liquid one, it is a more preferred modality. What about use of liquid cleansing agent? Let's talk about this. Skin may be cleansed by water alone or by adding in a liquid cleanser within the following essential property. Your liquid, if you are using a liquid soap, it is a pre-known irritant. It should be neutral or mildly acidic pH. pH of 5.5 to 7 is a preferred thing. Have a minimal effect on baby skin surface pH. Liquid cleanser do not alter the normal skin maturation process. Cost and availability may be the limiting factor use of these cleanser. Because when you compare the soap and the liquid things are a little bit more costlier. That is why most of the time they prefer to use in a soap thing. Do the cleansing wipes affect the skin barrier? To answer to this question, if you are using an inappropriately designed wipes may contain the soap or progress or an allergens that can cause an irritation, sensitization, and disruption of the skin barrier. That is why when you are using in a wipes, so just you need to take all these things into the consideration. What should be the ideal wipes? It should contain the pH buffers to maintain the acid mentally of the skin. Be free of a potential irritant like an alcohol, fragrance, or an essential oil, soaps, and harsh detergent like a sodium lauryl sulfate. They should contain a well-tolerated preservative. Appropriately designed wipes can be used from the birth, and cost and availability is the limiting factor in developing countries like India. Otherwise, these are the more preferred modality if they fulfill all these criteria. What future should be the ideal for a cleanser to have it? It should be mild and non-soap format is a thing. Liquid and should have a synthetic detergent and have a fragrance and color free and minimum preservative. pH should be acidic or a neutral, that is 5.5 to 7. And most importantly, to write it, it should be an affordable one. Acidic skin pH and skin barrier, we are talking too much about an acidic pH. Let's look into that. Newborn skin has a neutral pH. Over the first few months, it changes into the acidic pH. When especially as the gestational age in prematurity and all, it will be more alkaline or in neutral pH. Skin antimicrobial properties is ideal at an acidic pH. and desquamation of skin is best controlled at an acidic pH. If it is an alkaline pH, more likely to have a more susceptible for infection, and desquamation is very common. Inflammation is initiated and perpetuated at an higher pH. That is why we need to keep the pH in a lower level. Ceramide production is impaired at an alkaline pH. That is why acidic pH plays an important role. These are all the things which is we need to know as a practicing pediatrician. Maintaining the skin barriers in diaper area. Diaper area is one of the important things. It is more concerned with the dermatologist as well as a pediatrician. Keeping the diaper area clean and dry is our priority. When you are writing a nappy and cotton cloth nappies, which one to be used? So ideal is in a super absorbent nappies is a much better as compared to the cloth nappies. If you are using in a cloth nappies, what precautions we should take is double rinse to wash out all the soap content. That's more important thing. Diaper should be changed frequently as necessary to keep the area clean and dry. This is the one advice which makes a lot of differences in the day-to-day practice. We should advise the parent to clean the diaper area neat and keep it clean and dry. Gentle cleaning with the cotton balls or squares or a washcloth and water alone for specially designed wipes. Regular use of moisturizers if the barrier defect. Allow for the napkin pre-time. So infant should be free from the napkins. It should not wear the napkin all the time. What about the effect of tropical products on the skin barrier? Especially isopropyl alcohol causes an under occlusion in the preterm babies can cause an hemorrhagic skin necrosis. That means you better to avoid isopropyl alcohol preparation. Sodium lauryl sulfate can cause an irritation and disruption of the skin integrity. Propylene glycol is a higher strength, can cause a skin burning and irritation. Methyl sulfuricide, it is in shampoos or wipes, can cause an allergic contact dermatitis. Parabens can cause an allergic contact dermatitis, is a type of a preservative where it is likely to cause an allergic contact dermatitis. We should be very, very careful, but if we use it in appropriate quantity, it will not cause any much problem. Fragrance and colors can cause a contact reaction, and corticosteroids can cause a cutaneous atrophy, especially if you are using it in atopic dermatitis, we should be very, very careful on that. Skin barrier and clinical implications. Skin barrier defect can be considered, has been considered as an integral with the following disorder, like especially atopic dermatitis, food allergy, ichthyosis, irritant diaper dermatitis. These are all the common clinical thing, and psoriasis, these are all the common clinical condition which overlaps within a pediatric dermatologist and pediatrician. Let's look at the skin barrier and atopic dermatitis. When you look at the pathogenesis of an atopic dermatitis, so mainly basically it is an imbalance between the Th1 and Th2 cells. That is the main thing, Th1 and Th2 imbalance that creates a whole problem. Apart from the environmental and immune dysfunction and the skin barrier abnormality because of an environmental factor also. So these are the things I'll not go into detail because there is a one module in today, it is going to talk about an atopic dermatitis. I'll not take much time on this. The major contributor for skin barrier defect in atopic dermatitis, that is a decreased tight junction leading to the increased transepidermal water loss. Reduced filaggrin protein, that is genetic mutation, that leading into the reduced skin hydration. That means genetic factors plays an important role apart from the epidermal environmental factor. Alteration in the epidermal lipid composition that leads to the increased transepidermal water loss, decreased antimicrobial peptides leading to the increased skin infection. So that is why taking care of the skin in atopic dermatitis plays an important role in preventing the complication. Maintaining the skin barrier in children with atopic dermatitis, regular and liberal use of an appropriate moisturizer. Following an optimum bathing and cleaning practices, avoid the contact with the potential irritant, especially using a soaps when the skin barrier is disrupted. During that time, it is likely to cause a more irritation. Tropical anti-inflammatory agent that need to settle down the inflammatory episodes. If there is a secondary infection, that is the time where we need to use an antibiotic. Otherwise, in generally, it is not required. skin barrier and atopic, when you're looking that, is so preserving the skin barrier prevents the atopic dermatitis and atopic mark, conflicting evidence currently. When you look at these things into the consideration, atopic mark is an natural progression of an atopic disease from an atopic dermatitis in the infancy and allergic rhinitis in the toddler and asthma in the school age. You can't prevent it. Moisturizer therapy from the birth represents a feasible and safe and effective approach to the atopic dermatitis prevention. That only we are going to prevent the more complications rather than the progression. Skin moisturizers did not reduce the development of atopic dermatitis by the age of. So that means if you're using a skin moisturizer, that will not reduce it. That progression will be there. What we are intended is basically to prevent any complications. Let's look into the food allergy and the skin barrier. Food allergy is one of the commonest problem what we are all facing. Professor Nagaraj sir already brought it out in his opening remarks. Allergy is not the thing what we never used to recognize in the past. Now, with a lot of awareness is created by the allergic specialist like Professor Nagaraj, now the most of the pediatricians started identifying these allergic issues. Food allergies around 4 to 8% of the children. Transcutaneous sensitization to the allergen may contribute to the onset of food allergies. Skin barrier dysfunction disorder like atopic dermatitis, and these patients are high risk of transcutaneous sensitization, especially during the first year of life. Regular use of moisturizers may help in primary prevention of food allergy in a susceptible in patients. Let's look at the ichthyosis. Various gene mutation or enzymatic defect that contribute to the skin barrier dysfunction in ichthyotic disorder, especially in the ichthyosis vulgaris, where the filaggrin gene and transglutaminase 1 gene in a lamellar ichthyosis, steroid sulfatase enzyme in X-linked ichthyosis, regular use of an appropriate moisturizers and optimum cleansing and bathing practices helps in improving the skin barrier. Systemic therapies are available to improve the keratinization defect for some of the ichthyotic disorder. What is the carry-home message out of the last 25 to 30 minutes of our presentation is implant skin barrier serves an important function as an interface between the outside environment and internal thing. Skin barrier dysfunction can contribute to the pathogenesis of some of the skin disorder. That is why we need to be much aware. Appropriate moisturizers and optimum cleansing and bathing practices help to preserve, protect, and enhance the skin barrier. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, we can take it up.
Thank you, Dr. Basavaraj sir, for enlightening us on the infant skin barriers and the tips what we have given, how we need to take care of the infant skin. Also, the importance of about all the factors as barriers and how we need to prevent